And we're live again. Hello, everybody. Let me just see if you're joining. You are indeed, yes. So now I'm here with Hermann Hoch, who is well known as HH in the forums and on the lists, and is probably our most enthusiastic HTML5 user. So I persuaded him to come in here and demo some stuff for us.
Calm down.
Well,
so you hear my voice is... It's very down at the moment, so I had to make videos with a robot voice. I tried to get one with a German accent, but that wasn't available, so you have to hear the English voice, Daniel. I think it's best we start now, yes?
Let's get going. Let's just make sure everybody can see and hear us. So if I see Clarence has joined us there, if somebody else could also confirm that you can see and hear us properly. We're not having any problems with the streaming.
So we are three people, good enough to start.
Oh, here's Brian. Look, there's four. I think we actually have 49 if we look on air. Oh, Tyrone says yes. Jim, yeah, we're all good to go. We're good to go. So off you go. Load up your video and let's get started with what you've got for us.
About Affine and prospective transforms of graphics and images, live code global 17 by Hermann. This needs a preface. Some of the following slides look more mathy than they are. I'm trying to make it very basic. We only need addition, multiplication, sine and cosine. And a bit imagination for prospective transforms, rotating, scaling and skewing transforms. Some abbreviations and synonyms. LCB equals live code builder, LCS equals live code script, JS equals JavaScript. Shear equals skew. Shift x by t equals add t to x equals translate x by t. The contents. We will go fast, as a brush up, through the basic formulas for the affine transforms rotate, skew, scale and translate, and we use them to exercise a little bit the term matrix of LCB, which we use simply as list. The simple live code scripts for skewing and rotating will be given for your convenience. The main impact will be on prospective 4-point transforms, which contain the affine 4-point transforms as special case. For images, we explain the reverse lookup method which is needed to perform a prospective transform. The prospective method is, in LCS, already available on a stack on sample stacks. In order to speed up, I implemented a hybrid method that uses JavaScript in a browser widget for doing the lengthy color lookup very fast with the help of your graphics card. As a last application, it is shown how easy it is to use the 4-point prospective transform for mockups. There isn't much to do when customizing this technique for your own stacks. Let us start from an 1D affine transform. There we have x out equals s times x plus t. X is the input, x out is the output. For our current subject, 2D affine transforms, with accordingly two input coordinates, x and y, for each of the two output coordinates x out and y out, this gives us two equations. X out equals sx times x, plus ky times y, plus tx and y out equals kx times x, plus sy times y, plus ty. The coefficients are written as list and called a transformation matrix, sx, kx, ky, sy, tx, ty, containing the scale factors, sx and sy, skew factors, kx and ky, translate values, tx and ty. The order of the listing is important. Best remember it together with the equations and the attribute column-wise. Math talk, yes. The values underlaid with gray and the equations make up the linear algebra matrix. Remember also column-wise for the conversion from the matrix list to the linear algebra matrix and vice versa. End of math talk. For the more general case of an origin x0, y0 instead of 0, 0, we have to shift the input values, then collect the constant terms and get the matrix of parameters. Sx, kx, ky, sy, which is as in the basic formula, but now the constants are the collected ones tx minus sx times x0 minus ky times y0, ty minus kx times x0 minus sy times y0. So, all we have to remember for that general case is that changing the origin is done by changing accordingly the constants tx and ty in the basic form. Let us first look at the formulas. Try to say which matrix represents these formulas. The matrix lists will appear at the blue notes signs when we arrive at the bottom of the slide. The identity transform, which is needed for resetting, has x out equals x and y out equals y. Translation by tx and ty, which is needed for setting points relative to a fixed point, as the top left of an image, has x out equals x plus tx and y out equals y plus ty. Scale by sx and sy, which is needed for setting the width and the height, has x out equals x0 plus sx times x minus x0 and y out equals y0 plus sy times y minus y0. Skew x by ky, which goes along constant vertical lines, has x out equals x plus ky times y minus y0 and y out equals y. Skew y by kx, which goes along constant horizontal lines, has x out equals x and y out equals kx times x minus x0 plus y. For skewing by an angle of alpha, the factors kx or ky respectively are given by the tangents of alpha. Rotation by an angle of alpha has x out equals x0 plus the cosine of alpha times x minus x0 minus the sine of alpha times y minus y0 and y out equals y0 plus the sine of alpha times x minus x0 plus the cosine of alpha times y minus y0. Now let us look at the coefficient listings, the transformation matrices. The identity transform has matrix 1, 0, 0, 1, 0 and 0. Watch the order. Translate by tx and ty has matrix 1, 0, 0, 1, tx and ty. Scale by sx and sy has matrix sx, 0, 0, sy, minus sx times x0 and minus sy times y0. Skew x by ky has matrix 1, 0, ky, 1, minus ky times y0 and 0. Skew y by kx has matrix 1, kx, 0, 1, 0 and minus kx times x0. For rotation by an angle of alpha, let s equals the sine of alpha and c equals the cosine of alpha. Then it has matrix c, s, minus s, c, x0 times 1 minus c, plus s times y0, and y0 times 1 minus c, minus s times x0. Now let us collect lib code scripts for transforming graphics. Here is a simple method. Start with the formula and convert it to the LCS line marked with 2. For rotating 2 is put return, and x0 plus c times x minus x0 minus s times y minus y0 comma y0 plus s times x minus x0 plus c times y minus y0 after p out. For skew x2 becomes put return and x0 plus t times y minus y0 comma y after p out. For skew y2 becomes put return and x, comma, y0 plus t times x minus x0 after p out. For scaling 2 becomes put return and x0 plus sx times x minus x0, comma, y0 plus sy times y minus y0 after p out. For translating 2 becomes put return and x plus tx, comma, y plus ty after p out. Then put the coefficients that you need into variables in line marked with 1. For rotating 1 becomes put the sine of angle times pi over 180, into s put the cosine of angle times pi over 180, into c. For skewing 1 becomes put the tangents of angle times pi over 180, into t. For scaling 1 becomes put item 1 of scl into sx put item 2 of scl into sy. For translating 1 becomes put item 1 of trl into tx put item 2 of trl into ty. That's all.
So, sorry. I think we go directly to the demo stack. So, away from the theory to the examples. This is stack one. Here is it. Okay. I found it.
Let us have some visual examples. The image is just now only there because we don't want to stare at 4 points for several minutes. The blue sliders are controlling the affine parameters that transform the 4-point polygon. To see the effects isolated, we start from a rectangle. First, the horizontal scale, the x scale, setting positive values, that is moving within the right half of the slider, scales the width up or down. Moving within the left half of the slider does the same with the absolute value of the factor, but also flips the image horizontally, which is the effect from the minus sign. It's the same with the vertical scale, the y scale, setting positive values, that is moving within the right half of the slider, scales the height up or down. Moving within the left half of the slider does the same with the absolute value of the factor, but also flips the image vertically, which is the effect from the minus sign. Shearing parallel to the horizontal axis, the x skew has constant vertical values. Watch how the 4 points of the polygon move along horizontal lines. Negative angles, that is moving the slider to the left, skews the lower points to the left. Positive angles, that is moving the slider to the right, skews the lower points to the right and the upper points to the left. Shearing parallel to the vertical axis, the y skew has constant horizontal values. Watch how the 4 points of the polygon move along vertical lines. Negative angles, that is moving the slider to the left, skews the left points down. Positive angles, that is moving the slider to the right, skews the left points up and the right points down. No, we arrive only with skewing close to a rotation. Actually, rotating is not an atomic affine transform. It is a mix of the atoms of the affine transform, scale, skew and translate. So we can describe every rotation by the 6 values of these atoms, that is by one matrix. Now watch how the matrix values below the rotation slider change while rotating. To close this visual example, let us have a look at the matrix values, how they change. When a slider is moved, you see the value that changes in red color. Note that the sliders are not in the column-wise order of the affine transform matrix. X scale is first. Y scale is fourth. X skew has param ky and is third. Y skew has param kx and is second. X translate is fifth. And Y translate is sixth. Now we have 75% of a prospective transform matrix. Let us first look how such a matrix appears in our demo stack.
Yeah.
So, hello. Back again.
Back again.
We could have a first break for questions. That was everything to the affine transforms, because I think nearly everybody there has this intus. Are there questions for that to that part?
It looked extraordinary. I mean, can we just have the stack? We can just use that, Herman.
it is too easy for questions. So let's go to the perspective transform.
We start from a Y skew. Watch the two values in the bottom field of the palette. These are the prospective factors, which are both zero if we have only an affine transform. Now we wish to have the right edge shorter to look more far away. Leave the left side unchanged. We change the four-point polygon by moving its top right point to have such a distortion. The prospective factors change to small values. This shows that we need to know at least 8 exact decimals for these in order to get no harmful rounding errors. Above these two values is the affine part of the prospective matrix. We will see that this is indeed an ordinary affine transform if the prospective values are both zero. We notice now that the Y scale, that is parameter 4, is close to 1, although not exactly 1. Look at the relative points of the 4-point polygon, listed at the left of the palette. If we make the right line exactly vertical by editing these points, the Y scale factor should become 1. Now, how do we get the extended parameter list, the 8 coefficients of the prospective
theory. Okay.
A marginal note on use of affine transforms in LCB. The transformation matrices given above can be used in LCB and JS. The direct use of these transforms is only needed if we have thousands of points. For example, a polyline describing a coastline. You do it by transform path or canvas. By transform with matrix A, B, C, D, E, F. But usually we use in LCB the available commands to build a transform matrix. Scale transform by SX, SY, skew transform by KX, KY, translate transform by TX, TY, rotate transform by alpha. Then we transform path or canvas by that built transform. For an origin other than 0,0, you have to apply a translate before using and translate back after using one or several of these commands. The concrete translation values depend on your technique, whether either you transform the canvas to draw a path or you transform a path to draw on a canvas. End of marginal note. This is now the most important formula of the talk, still very simple. It will be used twice. First, the input values x and y, not the coefficients, are replaced by concrete numbers. This gives us a numeric problem to solve for the coefficients. Then, in a second step, the found coefficients are inserted, the input and output values remaining variable. Here it is. X out equals Sx times x plus Ky times y plus Tx over divisor and Y out equals Kx times x plus Sy times y plus Ty over divisor. The divisor is in both cases what makes up the difference to the basic affine transform formula. Px times x plus Py times y plus 1. The coefficients are written as list and called a prospective matrix, the first six coefficients being identical to the affine transform, Sx, Kx, Ky, Sy, Tx, Ty and two more, Px and Py containing the scale factors, Sx and Sy, skew factors, Kx and Ky, translate values, Tx and Ty, and prospective factors, Px and Py. So we have the four-point prospective transform, short, PT, contains as special case the affine transform, short, AT. That's why, in the four-point scenario, we do not need affine transforms, only for helping to shape the more general prospective transform. What is a four-point scenario? Roughly spoken, we have a four-point polygon that has only four sharp bends towards its outside. The middle figure has three points lying in the same straight line. The right figure is not convex. Math talk. We have non-collinear, convex quadrilaterals. End of math talk. Of course, it is simple to fix eight coefficients and then use the basic prospective form for any given input values. The more interesting situation, however, is to find the PT from one such four-point polygon, the input, to another one, the output. Step 1. Use what we have, the points of the polygons. So put the coordinates of the four input points and their corresponding output points, for example the top left, into the prospective base form. This gives us eight equations for the eight unknown parameters Sx, Kx, Ky, Sy, Tx, Ty, Px and Py, which makes up in our four-point scenario a solvable linear system. Step 2. Solve that system, what Carl Gauss did fast, without a computer. Now our computer needs 1 millisecond for that. In the following, our typical situation will be that the left polygon above is the rectangle of an image and the right polygon is the distorted rectangle. Then we don't need both transforms, PT1 and PT2. We need PT2, maybe surprising. So, why not PT1? It would be very hard to get unique, integer-valued coordinates x out and y out for every source pixel x and y, so that no pixel in the distorted rectangle is inserted or overwritten by the interpolation for a following pixel, so one goes the other way. Put an integer grid over the distorted rectangle and use the backward transform PT2. This starts from an integer-valued pixel, x, y, and reaches, after rounding or interpolation, a pixel, x out, y out. That would be the source if we would use the forward transformation. The color of that source is used for the start pixel, x, y. That is, the rounding or interpolation is done in the source, not in the distorted target. We have no missing pixel with that method, only the usual anti-aliasing problem at the border. Once again, in short, as illustrated in the figure, find the eight equations by using the known four input points from the distorted rectangle, and the associated four output points from the source image's rectangle. Solve that linear system and use the found eight coefficients for looking up in the source image the color for each pixel in the distorted rectangle. Note that a general solution, as a formula with variables, is not possible. For each prospective distortion, we have to solve numerically for the coefficients sx, kx, ky, sy, tx, ty, px and py of the backward transform. The demo stack prospective image distortion on sample stacks contains the complete libco script for that. The demo stack transforms LC global 17 moreover contains the following hybrid method. Step 1. Compute the prospective transform in LDS. Step 2. Look up the pixel color with JS, which uses the graphic card for speed up. The core routine is given here. It shall show how close JavaScript is to LibCode script. The zero base TM values are the coefficients of the transform. The basic form equations are splitted, just as in LibCode script, taking out for each row of the pixels the parts that...
We're back. We're back up here.
Perhaps we go before questions arise or more questions arise to the examples.
Prospective four-point transforms visually explained. We have helpers for changing the width, the height or both of them. We have helpers for mirroring the points, making parallels, or setting the points symmetric to their midpoints. And we have the affine transforms. For the last fine-tuning we can edit the relative points of the four-point polygon. Let us watch a few actions for the points editing. In sum, most of the options palette, inclusive the affine parameter sliders, eventually are helpers only for setting the distorted four-point polygon. As a marginal note, let us now see what the anti-aliasing, contributed by Bernd, can do. Look how smooth the diagonal line becomes by his gradient technique, though it takes some time to have it. A minor but a bit faster helper for hiding jagged borders is a frame. We use it here more for speed reasons. A short demo for the other helpers. The width. The height. The zoom, which works, as it should, for all allowed shapes. The horizontal mirror. The vertical mirror. Vertical symmetry. Horizontal symmetry. Making top and bottom line exactly horizontal. Making left and right line exactly vertical. Now let us look a bit closer at the prospective transform parameters, how they appear generated from affine transforms. Recall that the transform is the backward transform. So, if we apply, starting from a rectangle, an affine transform to the four-point polygon, we see the red factors while dragging and can watch the corresponding item in the line below. The prospective factors should be both zero. The reverse should be, for a scale factor, the reciprocal of that factor, from 2.190 to 0.583, from minus 0.667 to minus 1.497. For a skew factor, the negative of that factor from 0.237 to minus 0.236, with a rounding error, in our field display only, in the last digit. For a translate value factor, the negative of that value. Let us have a closer look at rotation. We now see what the problems will be if you apply it in LCS to a grouped image or use it in a widget or use via JS with a JS transform. It is the clipping by the parent object. We don't have any problem with the perspective transform in LCS and JS, but of course also in LCB, where the adjusting of the widget size is currently only possible from LCS needing allowed script access. Now a demo of things happening when we use distortions that are not of the allowed 4-point polygon type. First a collinear polygon, then non-convex and self-intersecting examples. The algorithm will not crash, but you'll get crazy looking output. As soon as you revert to an allowed polygon shape, you'll get again a correct perspective transform. Once again a marginal note, flipping does not change the polygon, it flips the images only. Look closer at our lovely girl to see the effect. Flipping is a point where the paint compression comes in. You have to set the paint compression to PNG when using Base64 encoding decoding, else your data has the wrong format and nothing will happen. Let's now have a look at the HTML and JavaScript used for the hybrid method. The perspective base form has the JS script part that is now highlighted. The rest are image filters. The call to the JavaScript handler of the browser widget is the line at bottom. The distorted image data is the Base64 encoded to data URL, sent back to live code. The mentioned image filters are the few lines in the middle. HTML5 makes it very comfortable to access image data. Let me give a short demo for the filters. They can be applied all together. Pretty fast for that, the graphics card helps here a lot. The RGB filter will have its own demo later on, when we demo mockups. Mockups are our final subject. The principle is clear. It will be more, from my point of view, of...
Here we are. Okay.
So, I was just typing, sorry. So, this is now a point where you... we could have some questions and answers. I see here one, or I don't know, have I missed one, Heather?
I see that George has asked if you could do these same kinds of manipulation with 3D objects.
Yes, of course you can do that. There are also a lot of JavaScript libraries to do that, but this is not a real goal for my work. What I would like to do is always to have live code as the core of the project, and only use JavaScript for lengthy things that live code cannot do. It's impossible to do this so fast. It's JavaScript is sometimes even faster than C++ or an external, because this ability to use the graphics card was very much improved in the last years. And you see, you have seen the images are really big, and you would need with a live code script close to 10 or for the larger ones, 20 seconds to do an image filter. And the JavaScript is doing that in half a second. So yeah. This is fantastic. But the processing of that transformed images is much more comfortable to have in live code. You have a lot of options for additionally to set inks. You have a lot of options to work with gradients. Bernd uses that for the anti-aliasing. Look at the examples in the web of the JavaScript sites. They don't have such a pretty anti-aliasing that we have with the method of Bernd. So I see. The image library, I have already a stack, two stacks, also one for use in live code 6 and 7, uses the ref browser function, not the widget. And in 6.7, this works sometimes even faster than what you have seen. Not really with live code DP10. This is now, meanwhile, the fastest live code version for handling images. It's even faster than 6.7.11. Live code gets the power of the graphics card. Jorge gets the power of the graphics card via JavaScript. We use the JavaScript in a browser widget. That's the lib browser that the widget uses. It's not, hopefully will be updated soon. Does that. It's on Mac, it's simply the webkit. The same that the Safari uses. You have only these neat features on top of that you don't have in live code. But I don't use HTML I don't use it for things that I can do at the same speed or sometimes even faster in live code. The image library there are a lot of filters in the sample stacks. The one is using the browser widget, one is using ref browser function. I will soon update these image stacks with how should I say, several contributions by Wilhelm Sanke. I met him recently, and there will be about 250 wonderful filters he collected in the last years, and I've already implemented most of them. This will be a great stack there, that where you can do some things that you can't do in professional apps. They are because they are so special that okay, you can have plugins. There are a lot of excellent developers who make plugins, but you have it in live code, and you don't have to know the special. Don't have to have a special knowledge of JavaScript. All you have to know is the how to set the JavaScript handlers. This is so you have seen the HTML5 script, how short this was. This is so so easy. You go back. The only thing you need is base64 encoding and decoding for transporting the image data. This is you have to do that for big data. The first one who made this visible, I say yes, visible for us to us was Jonathan. Jonathan, thanks again for that thing. I read your data transfer sample stack, and I got an enlightening as Goethe in his last days. Okay. So I think we should go on, or did I have? Yes, okay. So we go on with an application for that. I hope you will like that. That was the most fun for me to make when I made this talk.
Is there a useful application for four-point perspective transforms of images? I'll make you now a proposal. Decide thereafter. At first, our lovely girl would like to have a break. The owl shall demonstrate the great performance of the hybrid method. Now start using mockups. We have several pictures for inserting. They don't really fit from their proportions. I did not yet implement downscaling of the images for proportional inserting. You will certainly use for your own slideshow a mockup and images that fit optimally to each other. The following little slideshow is manually triggered by arrow keys. An animated 2 seconds interval is also available in the stack. Yesterday I added a script that lets you easily get the points of the distortion polygons relative to the top left of the mockup image. We use the message box for that. This outdates my final slide, which you'll see after the current video. You can also use your distorted image as modern glass that simply dissolves when needed. The mockup GIFs play as usual GIFs. Yes, you can use a GIF as a mockup. We now show the usage of the RGB filter. We can use it to calibrate the screen of the laptop. Let us close here with some quick and dirty made mock animations. You cannot use a GIF as an inserted image. We use instead the single frames of a GIF and make our own animation. It's not optimized. Could run a bit faster. You certainly know this GIF, which is based on the work of Edward Muybridge. Thank you.
I have a final slide that lasts 1 minute, okay?
Yeah, go for it.
Where's the end? Here's it.
Back to our lovely girl. It wants to change the bus stop. A nice effect from a GIF. Of course, we could also play, vice versa, a GIF in a static background. Although preparing 60 to 100 prospective transformed frames of a GIF would need some time. I'll better leave that to you. Colon minus double right parenthesis. Herman, you are really joking. How should I speak such a smiley? Let us have our finish in Paris. They are already announcing Live Code Global 2018 there. Oh, sorry, I forgot to update. You see that? The rehearsal is already running. We have seen that the prospective transform is a perfect tool for mockups. Set manually the points of the prospective polygon, then get the points and remember them for that mockup. It remains a note to the point saving. Obviously, it may be of advantage to do that relative to the top left of the mockup image. You have to adjust the demo stack for that. You may use the following script to see what is meant with that. We set the saved points of the mockup image to the points of the distortion polygon. Now you can use that for a slideshow. Thanks for watching.
So we are back to you. Oh, wow. Well, thank you so much for that, Herman. It was very exciting. Although we are not committed to doing Live Code Global in Paris. I'm sorry. This is not, we were not consulted on this.
No, it's global. It's global. So, but there could be a public view in Paris of Live Code Global.
Well, so, yes, perhaps.
So I think the best thing would be that the people get the stack and play with it. All videos were made with my stack. So the example videos are all made with it, and the end is a bit outdated because you have the script to get the points. Look at the stack and you see how easy it is. It is really easy. You don't feel the math. You don't have to know much math. You have seen the formulas. And just watch what you should do as a last sentence. If you use LCP, train the order of the parameters in the matrix. This is the source of the most errors. Look at Stack Overflow and you see it. The people are interchanging the params. So train that and everything is very, very easy. Hope else. Yeah. Okay.
Well, I think it will be easy if we take a stack, Herman, and then we use the copy and the paste button.
There is one, yes.
It was beautiful. Thank you so much.
Let me say one thing to the copyright. The animated GIFs are copyrighted. So please don't use these. Yes? I had the allowance to use it in my stack, but don't use it. You can buy that for really cheap if you need a lot of them, but don't use the animated ones off my stack, okay? So thank you. Heather, thank you for the preparation. It's hard to exercise if one should it do it more than one time. So you people have such a lot to exercise to have the webinar. But it's a really, I think, a really good thing. For me, it's really good. Wow. I booked the next. The next one already. So sorry for the delay. And but we have a break now, no? No?
Yes. Well, no. We have Kevin next. Kevin is doing the monthly report next.
Kevin, sorry had to wait. Okay. Well, thank you, Heather.
Okay, so everybody, come back here in a couple of minutes, and we will have Kevin telling you what we've been doing this month.